You've probably heard of a man-in-the-middle attack, or maybe even tried one, but have you ever wondered why attacks like these are even possible, or what weaknesses in a network allow them to happen? Well, the answer lies in something fundamental.
Protocols.
Protocols are a set of rules that tell a device what to do or how to communicate, in order to exchange data over a network. In this video, I'll walk you through some of the common networking protocols found in places like homes or offices, and explain how understanding or exploiting them can open doors to many valuable attacks that you didn't know were even possible. So let's get started. This video is sponsored by Any.Run. Whether you're testing system vulnerabilities or identifying potential threats, malware analysis is something that every IT specialist can benefit from, and that's where AnyRun comes into play. AnyRun is a cloud-based sandbox that lets you analyze how a malware operates by running it in a controlled environment, and unlike using traditional virtual machines, it offers some unique advantages, such as securely isolating threats to prevent malware from escaping into your network, or providing access to a vast library of samples to choose from. Its interface is designed to be beginner-friendly while remaining powerful enough for experts, and includes various tools that let you view all the network connections a malware is making, or the commands it is executing. With their new product called Safe Browsing, you can also check whether a website is safe to visit or not, and features like these are what make AnyRun act like an essential assistant, helping you make informed decisions about your business or work networks, and enabling you to decide whether to block specific entities or not. To try it out, you can visit their website, and take advantage of their Black Friday promotional offers, to get the most out of this amazing tool at an unbeatable price. Thanks for listening, let's get back to the video.
Chapter number 1, What the hell are protocols?
Okay, so at the start of the video, I mentioned that protocols are a set of rules that tell a device what to do or how to communicate, but if you've seen my last video on networking basics for hackers, you might be wondering,
aren't IP addresses and MAC addresses enough to send data over a network? Where do protocols come in?
Well, that's where things get interesting. Think of it like sending a letter in the mail. When you send a letter to someone, you write their name, address, and apartment number, so the mail service knows exactly where it's going, simple enough, right? But what if instead of sending a letter, you were sending a fragile vase? Would you just toss it in a box and send it off the same way? Well, of course not. You'd label the box with a handle with care sign, letting everyone know that it's fragile and needs special handling. That's exactly what protocols do for data. IP addresses and MAC addresses tell your network where the data should go, like a mailing address does, but protocols on the other hand instruct the network on what kind of data it's dealing with, and how to handle it. So if you're loading a web page on your laptop, your device attaches an HTTP protocol letting your router know it's a web request, whereas if you're making a voice call on WhatsApp, it uses a protocol that lets the router know it's voice data and instructs it to handle it differently. Now, similar to how a handle with care sign can tell someone on both what is being sent and how to handle it, protocols are also split into two types. The first type, known as data protocols, tell the network what type of data it's dealing with, which includes protocols like HTTP or RTP that we just talked about, whereas the second type, called control protocols, tell the network how to handle that data or deliver it, and this may include protocols like DNS or DHCP, that we'll talk about later in the video.
Disclaimer.
Before we move forward, I want to clarify that this video is intended for cybersecurity enthusiasts and is for educational or awareness purposes only. It is documentary in nature and does not provide step-by-step guide on how to exploit network protocols. Black hat hacking is highly discouraged and can result in serious legal consequences.
Chapter number 2, Exploiting protocols in homes.
Okay, so now that we know what protocols are and the two main types they're divided into, let's take a look at some of the essential ones found in almost every network, and understand how hackers exploit them to perform various malicious tasks.
Protocol number 1, DNS.
DNS is a control protocol which acts like a table, provided by your ISP to your router, in order to translate a website's domain name into an IP address, allowing your device to connect to a website's server over the internet. Now, if you're not sure about what that means or why it's done, I'd recommend checking out the previous video and building a strong foundation, but for now, just know that DNS was originally created as devices only knew how to communicate using IP addresses, while humans found it much easier to remember website names instead of long strings of numbers. But here's where things got interesting. Today, if a hacker gains access to someone's home network and manages to log into their router's control panel, they could replace the DNS table stored on the router with a fake one they've created, and perform something called a DNS hijacking attack. This would allow the hacker to redirect every device connected to the router to a fake website whenever they try to visit the legitimate one, and from there, they could potentially download a malware on that device, or trick the users with a phishing page in order to steal their passwords. Now, a point to keep in mind here is that while this attack might seem easy to do and foolproof, that's not always the case. Most modern devices are configured to store a DNS cache locally, which basically allows them to access frequently visited sites more quickly, and so if an address is already cached on a targeted device, it won't need to query the router for that domain, meaning that the hacker's changes to a router won't take immediate effect. This is why hackers often try to physically clear out the DNS cache stored locally on a targeted device, or perform something called a DNS spoofing attack that we'll talk about later in the video.
Protocol number 2, NAT and DHCP.
Recalling the previous video once again, you'll remember that there are two types of IP addresses. The first one is called a private IP, while the other one is called a public IP address. Private IPs are used for communication with devices inside a local network, which are usually assigned by a protocol within the router called DHCP, while public IPs are used for communication with devices outside the local network or over the internet, and these are created when another protocol called NAT converts the private IP of a device to the public IP of a router whenever it tries to connect to the internet. Now if you're confused about what this means or why we even need two IP addresses, go revisit the previous video once again, but for now, just know that because of the critical roles these two protocols play, they are often targeted by hackers as a part of some larger attack strategies rather than individual exploits, which makes them irrelevant for the scope of this video, but just for your understanding, here are some interesting attacks on NAT that you can pause the video to read, while here are some other ones for DHCP.
Protocol number 3, ARP.
Okay, so now that we know devices use private IPs to communicate inside a local network, and public IPs when communicating outside the network, there's one more thing we need to understand here. When devices do communicate inside a local network, they don't just rely on private IPs to share information, but also need something called a MAC address to ensure that data reaches the right place, and this is where ARP comes into play. Now if you're wondering why we even need MAC addresses when every device on a network already has a private IP assigned to them, you'll need to study something called the OSI model to understand the difference between a logical and a physical address, but for now, just know that if we take this local network as an example, and here if device B wants to send a message to device C, what device B will do is first ask ARP what MAC address is associated with this IP address, and then when ARP responds with the correct MAC address which would be of device C, device B will send the data directly to device C through the router. And so this is basically why ARP is used within a network. Now when we talk about exploiting ARP, this is where the famous man in the middle or an ARP spoofing attack comes into play. If you're not already familiar with what it is, I'd highly recommend you watching this video as it covers everything in detail, but for now, just know that in this type of attack, a hacker basically uses a tool called EtherCAP to trick the ARP and position themselves between two devices, which ultimately allows them to capture or monitor any data transmitted between them using another tool called Wireshark, and this is where the second type of protocols that I mentioned at the start of the video come into play. Up until now, all we've talked about were control protocols, but when it actually comes to capturing or analyzing data between two devices, you really need to understand what data protocols mean and how they function, so you can identify what type of data is being transmitted over a network, and whether the protocol being used is vulnerable to exploit or not. So what I'd like you to do here is pause the video and take a closer look at some of these common data protocols used for things like gaming or streaming, as understanding them will make it much easier for you to analyze or read data effectively the next time you use a tool like Wireshark.
Chapter number 3, exploiting protocols in schools and offices.
Okay, so now that we know how basic networking protocols can be exploited, let's take a look at some of the special ones found in places like schools or offices, and for this, what I want you to do is imagine a hacker who's managed to gain access to a corporate's internal network, and is now scanning it with a tool like Nmap. If you're not already familiar with what Nmap is or how it's used, I'd recommend checking out this video to learn more, but for now, just know that it's basically a tool you can use to find all the protocols running on a network, and after the hacker has finished running their scan, they discover the following protocols being used. So let's take a look at them one by one to see why they're critical, and whether they're vulnerable to attack.
Protocol number 1, FTP.
FTP is a simple protocol used to share files between computers, and it's often found in places like schools or offices as it supports collaborative tasks, allowing multiple people or departments to share files easily. However, if a hacker identifies that FTP is being used within a network, they can potentially access all the data stored on the server either by attempting to log in using default usernames and passwords, or by performing a man-in-the-middle attack. The reason why FTP is vulnerable is because it sends every piece of information, whether it's login credentials or shared files, all in plain text without encryption, making it easier for attackers to capture or analyze data effectively. Now to get around this, companies often use secure versions like FTPS or SFTP, which basically encrypt the data in transit. However, I only decided to include FTP here as many corporations still rely on older systems to avoid the hassle of upgrades, which makes it worthwhile for a hacker to scan a network and see if any outdated protocols are being used.
Protocol number 2, Telnet.
Telnet is another protocol commonly used in schools or offices to remotely access or configure devices over a network, but just like FTP, it has a significant security flaw as it transmits all data in plain text without encryption, making it vulnerable to a man-in-the-middle attack. A more secure version of Telnet is SSH.
Number 3, all the remaining protocols.
Okay, so as the purpose of this video was only to give you an introduction to what network protocols are and the different ways they can be exploited, I decided to skip the rest of the protocols here to keep the video short. However, you can download this table that I personally created by clicking on the link in the description down below. It contains all the vulnerable protocols along with their exploitation methods and secure versions, so you know what you're dealing with the next time you use a tool like Nmap. Anyway guys, so that's it for the video. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments section down below, and I'll see you in the next one.